The views and opinions of the Nissan Nation podcast are simply that. They are views and opinions of its guests or hosts. They do not reflect Nissan corporate or otherwise. Now, a DRB and KGB media presentation, the Nissan Nation podcast. Hit it, Kelly.
Recorded live, coast to coast, it's the Nissan Nation podcast. From camping, racing, and all points in between. The NNP is your Nissan Nation podcast. Now start your engines and welcome in your hosts, David, Danny, and Holden.
What is going on, Nissan Nation? From all things Nissan here in Middle Tennessee to Jackson Hole, Wyoming, this is your Nissan Nation podcast, and holy cow. That's all I can say, man. A month or so ago, Nissan Trucks hit us up on the podcast, and they were like, hey, do you got time for an adventure? And I discussed it with our guys, and I was like, hey, do we have time for adventure? And sure enough, we did. And me and Danny were able to get some time free and go cover an event that Nissan was doing. They did hashtag Titan Adventures, or hashtag Titan Adventure, I should say, which was freaking epic, man. I'm not going to lie. They wined and dined us. They wined and dined press. They wined and dined enthusiasts. And they made sure that the Titan lifestyle was very well represented this week. I cannot say enough to Miss Wendy over there at Nissan Corporate and her staff. I cannot say enough to David Page and his staff at Fluid Peak for just showing everybody the time of their life. They were very hands-on. This wasn't like they just set it up and just, you know, sent us off to some tour guide or something. They had a big epic week planned. So they sent us on snowmobiling, which I'd never done. They sent us on a recovery mission where they buried a Nissan Titan in like a 4 or 5 foot drift of snow out in a field, and it showed us how to recover it. They took us on an adventure, a wildlife adventure. We did a sleigh ride through the middle of a national forest where there was these elk just herding around, and there were this like ducks and all kinds of stuff. And like on cue, it was like Nissan had completely set this up for day one when we got there, that they had an eagle fly down. Of course, they didn't have an eagle fly down, but it was just like, it was so perfectly planned. So what happened was, we answered the call, and the call of the Titan, as it were, and we flew in. Danny flew from L.A. I flew here from Nashville, Tennessee. I flew from there to Newark, New Jersey, where I met up with our buddy Scott Gould. If you don't remember, Scott was the guy that a few years back had his Frontier stolen, and we put the big SOS out and tried to help recover that, which he ended up getting partially back. Scott's an epic guy, man. He built the, if you ever seen a yellow Titan in Moab on 37s doing trails that truck should not be on, that's Scott, man. Scott is a great guy. Sorry. I'm so excited I can't even speak. But so Miss Wendy Orthman over there at Nissan, I want to say a huge thank you for inviting us. David Page, I want to say a huge thank you for inviting us. We kind of pulled the wool over his eyes a little bit because they only invited one of us, and somehow we snuck two in. And I'm not going to explain how we did that, but we did. And I also want to say thank you to Holden at Regal Nissan, who he kind of helped facilitate some of these things behind the scenes. So we love you, buddy. Sorry you couldn't be on the adventure with us, but I think you were in Disney or something. You know, me and Danny were in adult Disney, and Danny or Mr. Holden there, he was in Kid Disney, so that's all right. We give Holden a little ribbing for that, but I think he would probably like to be on the Titan Adventures as well. But so in the email we got, it was very vague. It was like, hey, do you have time for adventure? And if so, basically, you know, give us some information about you. So we did all that. The plane ticket showed up, and it was time to go. So I left out from here in Middle Tennessee, flew to New York, or right outside of New York, and from there I flew all the way to Jackson Hole, Wyoming. And it's a long flight, but a good flight. Me and Mr. Scott Gould, we met up. We also met up with our buddy, I think it's White Lightning Titan, Chuck. Chuck, I apologize right now. I can't remember your last name, but epic dude. We all three met up, and we flew off to adventure, man. So me and Scott, we were sitting right next to each. Well, not, I won't say right next to each other. We were in the same row. And the all week, man, we've been watching these flights, and it wasn't a completely full flight, so we were like, oh, cool. We'll have a seat in between us. We can stretch out and just enjoy the 4.5-hour flight. And no. I didn't know a ton about Jackson, Wyoming, other than it's a pretty a ski resort town. But I guess in the New York area, man, when they hear about the snow that Jackson Hole was getting, it was like all hands on deck and let's go. So it was a waspy flight, but a fun flight. And we got to say, we had a guy that was probably like 6'5" sitting in between us from Poland. He now lives in the United States, but this guy had excitement for the snow, and he'd been there several times. And the whole flight, the whole 4.5-hour flight, man, he just let us know how exciting this was going to be. But so we get there, and in the email it even read, hey, be ready as soon as you go for the adventure of a lifetime. And you know, you hear that and you think, oh, it's just their little slogan or whatever, and we're going to get there, we're going to be able to sit down and you know, have a few minutes to kind of relax, we'll unpack our bags, and then we'll meet up and, you know, we'll see what goes on. Nope. Mr. David Page and Nissan, they said no. You're going to go as soon as you fly in. So we flew in. We just like you'd seen the movies, you know, your name's up there on a board, their Titan Adventure. Me and Scott get our bags, and Chuck, we get our bags, and we can't even get in the truck before they're handing us these beautiful blue jackets. I think it's Marimont, or I can't remember the I can't remember the name of the company. Let's see. It's Marmot. It's a lifestyle. They do clothing and all that kind of stuff. They donated some beautiful jackets. I mean, these had to be very expensive jackets. And they give us a packet. It had everybody's kind of name, a little bit about them, and it was just you know, very professional. And they took us right from a coffee shop where we met up, and I got to meet some of Nissan corporate. And I bet it wasn't 20 minutes later, we were back on the road, and time to adventure, man. So they took us right for a nice sleigh ride through that national park. Like I was saying earlier, that it was like, I don't know, man. I can't explain it. It was any animal, it seemed like, from that part of the world was right there in your face and ready to be viewed and have its picture taken with you. Like on cue, like I said earlier, it was like right on cue as we were finishing up. Here come this bald eagle just gracing by us, man. And just, you know, full of American pride is what that bald eagle was. But they, our guides on that tour, man, they explained why these elk and stuff were in this particular spot. They, you know, just gave us the whole history of the park. They knocked me out. And this is, I mean, we're in the first hour and a half of being there, and it's like on, game on. And after that, you get out of the sleigh and stuff, and you're kind of talking to people, and whether it be for some of the press that I wanted to talk to or just Nissan, and they were like, all right, so now we're going across the street. And I was like, across the street? What is that about? And there was a museum there, and it slips my mind at the moment of what the name of the museum was, but it was like, it was a wildlife museum where they had all kinds of just amazing art from 1700s to 1800s to contemporary artists with photography and stuff. They had, it was in this like 56,000 square feet building. It was just an amazing architectural wonder, the building itself. And we get in there, and there is a table set. I mean, and you'll see pictures and stuff we'll post on Facebook and Instagram. And I've got a video coming for this on YouTube. And it was just, there was a full bar sitting there. So everybody grabbed a drink and just started getting to meet everybody. And I can't even describe, like I said, I've got pictures of this that I will post up, but I can't even describe the layout. And it was like a 5-course meal. And it was one of the more fancier meals I've ever had. And I'm just blown away, man. So Nissan Corporate was there, and they were kind of telling us a little bit about what was going on. They kind of introduced themselves, and they had Mr. Corey Barr come up, who is he owns a restaurant. If you you can get on Instagram and just it's Parish Restaurant or CoreyBarr.com or ChefCoreyBarr.com. Check him out, man. He's been on TV many times, kind of a celebrity chef, amazing cook. And he introduced himself, and Nissan introduced themselves. There was all kinds of brand ambassadors there, whether it be from the camping supply company, this awesome rock climber. She, you know, introduced herself. And then they had everybody just kind of stand up and, you know, tell your story, basically. So when you know when it gets to me and Danny, we're like, we are not afraid to talk it by any means. So, you know, Danny introduced himself from the Titan XD program or on Instagram, the Titan XD page. I introduced myself, obviously, Danny, to a part of the podcast. And, you know, we told them what we were about, man. We were about the brand and the, our listeners. So I think they really enjoyed that. And you know, this wasn't just like, it just wasn't a bunch of PR people there. So they had the head of the commercial truck line was there. And he introduced himself and kind of told us a little bit of what was going on. And this was, like I said, this was a special deal, man. I can't even imagine what this cost to do. I mean, it was well five figures of what this event cost and to put on. If not six figures, that's the kind of money they spent just to talk to their people. They wanted to actually get real world feedback, not just somebody, you know, they're feeding pizza to, just trying to, you know, check the boxes of what they like about a Titan or not. And from there, we went back to our cabins where we had some more drinks, and they kind of laid out the plan for what was going to happen. And day one, it was on, man. So they had probably, let's see, they had two Armadas sitting there. They had the Snow Patrol, which, oh man, I'm a fanboy about that truck. I really am. I just, the wrap on it is just amazing. It's lifted a little bit. Looks like it had some 35s on it. Mud trains. I mean, you're talking, it's an Armada, you know, you're a refined vehicle and you're putting mud tires and stuff on it. And they were like, you guys are driving today. And I was like, I call it Snow Patrol. Nope. I just jumped right in the seat. I was like, this one's mine. I own a Titan. It's like, yeah, I'll drive a Titan later. I want to drive this Armada. And, so we went out and, we did some snowmobiling, but on the way, so we stopped off and outfitted ourselves with some snow gear, all courtesy of Nissan once again. And, I got to ride with some very special people. So if you're ever on Instagram, and I know they have a Facebook page as well, our first round of Titan interviews is a special lady. She, they go by the handle Cherokee Titan. And, I just wanted to talk to them and, do, you know, see what made them tick and why they bought the Nissan Titan. So without further ado, let's get the actual live action from the event. And, this is the Cherokee Titan here on the Nissan Nation podcast. All right, so we've got, what is your truck called? Cherokee Titan, is that right?
Yes, sir.
So what, kind of tell us about it, because we've just met you here on this Nissan adventure, and like, y'all are from Texas, right?
Right.
Okay, so we're in snow, so I'm assuming you don't see a lot of snow where you're from?
not where we're at now, but we used to live in Oklahoma, so
we have
seen snow.
So you
in
have
the past.
See, yeah. So the white stuff's not
it's not totally new, but yeah, we don't. It's fun to go visit it.
Yeah. That's me. I'm in Nashville, and I'm like, they were like, hey, trip to snow. I'm like, okay, because we don't see this, you know. But so kind of what led you to the Titan brand?
We have had Nissans throughout the years. Like I said, when we met 21 years ago, he was driving a Nissan hard body, and our first date was in a Nissan, and we've had two Armadas since then. We actually had a girl that we had guardianship of. Her first car was an Altima that we found for her.
Nice.
So we've been through that, and then whenever we went looking for trucks, it had more stuff available with it that would do the things we needed to do. Since being a veterinarian, I go off road a lot, so I need to be able to get in there and get out and get back,
right?
And so we, you know, looked into the Titans, and you know, the Titan is such an amazing ride, just you know, for day to day.
What were you comparing it to when you were looking for trucks?
We have had, oh gosh, I don't know. We've been Dodge people forever also, but we've mainly had the Cummins. So that was one of the big things we were looking for, was that it did have that Cummins motor.
So y'all have the XD Cummins.
We have the Cummins Platinum Reserve, yes.
Nice. So do you think it was a price point maybe, that because you were getting the diesel? But I think the Titan is a bargain, really, when you compare it to some of the maybe larger trucks.
Considering what you get in the truck, yes. Yeah. There's more features in these trucks than you're going to find. I mean, we have the Rockford Fosgate stereo system and, you know, the nice navigation screens and things like that. It's a nice, you know, you open up the door and people are shocked when they look in to see what you got in
right.
the truck.
Right. And you said you have the Platinum Edition, right?
We do.
So wood trim and all that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's the top of the line one, best one you could find.
Nice. Well, how many miles have y'all put on that thing?
It's pushing 70,000. We got it October 2016, and it's pushing because if you buy it, I want to drive it.
Yeah.
And I love to drive it.
Yeah, and as a vet, I would think yes, you're always on the road.
Exactly. You know, I take it back and forth to work, and we'll go play out in the mud and everything else, going looking at cows, or, you know, sometimes you get off places where people can't get out and you have to go to them.
Right. Well, have you done any modifications to your truck?
A few.
Well, tell us about a few.
The first thing we did, we put a 6-inch Fabtech. It's got the performance suspension with the Dirt Logic Resi coilovers. We started out with some 33s. We put it on 35s, which that took a little modification. We've got the amp research steps, which I love. If them people ever want me to advertise.
I think you are now.
I will advertise. I told them, I said, you know, there's a sticker out there that says, you know, because fat girls won't jump. I said, for amp research, because old chicks won't jump or can't jump.
Yeah, you're right. So, and that is the thing when you start lifting a vehicle. It's like,
I love those things.
Either some kind of rock rail or steps of some sort.
And definitely. The steps. Like I said, I could do an amp research commercial right here, but I can actually use my amp research to reach over the bed of that truck with a 6-inch lift to move stuff from the front. I can kind of get around with it.
Well, it looks like we are in a new, I'm going to say this is a 19 because it's got the Fender sound system in it. I can see a few upgrades. Do you see anything that they've sort of kind of upgraded in this vehicle?
Like I said, the Fender stereo system, like I said, that's definitely different. What's that?
It's a different screen.
Yeah, the screen is definitely different.
It looks like this one has two charging ports there.
Mm-hmm. Ours has two. They're in different locations. Mm-hmm. It looks like they've actually got, even in the back, is there a USB back there?
There are. There are two USBs.
Yeah, we saw that last night. Ours doesn't have that.
Mine doesn't.
Ours has the 12-volt in the back, and you flip the switch over on the side to turn that on.
It looks like this one has cooled seats as well.
Exactly, and ours has the heated and cooled.
So tell me a little bit about when Nissan, I'm assuming they sent you something on Instagram?
Yes, sir.
So I mean, were you kind of taken back a little bit, like, or do you have any kind of connection here?
We saw, what was it, Randy had gotten his invitation, and I was like, well, this is interesting, I wonder what's going on.
Right. Yeah.
And, you know, our truck, of course, we have changed out the grill and modified lights and things like that. Mm-hmm. Trying to keep it still tasteful, but we've been showing ours. You know, we work it, but we also take it to shows.
Right.
And David Page had seen it on the Nissan Trucks Facebook page. Mm-hmm. We posted a picture on there. And anyway, it kind of led to him friending us on Facebook. And he was like, you got an Instagram page? I was like, well, yeah. Well, the truck has its own Instagram page and its own Facebook page.
Right.
So it's kind of its own entity out there. And then they sent us a invitation. And I don't think we hesitated. We were like, yeah, we're there.
Yes, free trip and get to go test Titans and snowmobiles. Yes.
Well, Nathan, my husband, he had wanted to, we had said something about like a month before. He goes, I want to go to Jackson Hole.
Really?
And I you know, always be careful what you wish for. So here we are a month later after him saying, I'd sure like to go to Jackson Hole. This was before any of the Titan Adventure even came to life.
Right.
And here we are.
Nice. And it's nice to do it on somebody else's dime too, you know?
Well, there's nothing wrong with that. Well, we have totally enjoyed the experience, so it's been above and beyond, and we've only been through day one. We're just now starting day two.
Right, and what was interesting is, you know, in the kind of emails they send out, they're like, hey, as soon as you get off the plane, get ready. And they were not lying.
No, they were not, because we didn't see our luggage until we got back to the cabin last night.
Right. And of course, I'm coming from Nashville, so you know, it was 70 degrees there yesterday.
Right.
So I'm like, my clothing options weren't ready yet for when they were like, let's go, so... But so we got to do the sleigh ride and stuff, which was really, really neat.
It was so interesting. The sleigh drivers, we was laughing, they make sure not to call them slave drivers, but the sleigh drivers are so knowledgeable about the elk.
Well, and I imagine, like, as being a vet, that's like, this was really up your alley, right?
It was. I told them, you know, anything after the sleigh ride, I'm good. You know, everything else is gravy after this. So to go through there and see that many animals in one place and just... They try to keep the reserve as natural as it can possibly be, mm-hmm. and you know, they just supplement the elk once in a while, so it's neat to see that they can actually bring those animals in so you can actually see something that you wouldn't get to see anywhere else.
And the tour, of course, they were really knowledgeable, but I swear they hire an eagle to come in right at the end of the tour.
It was gorgeous.
Yeah,
was
and that eagle swoops down right at the end. I mean, it couldn't have been, the timing couldn't have been better.
I think somebody was on a mic somewhere saying, okay, cue the eagle.
Well, I can't wait. We're about to do some snowmobiling, so maybe we'll talk again after we do this this adventure here.
That sounds awesome.
And that was the Cherokee Titan. Thank you for spending some minutes with us in a Titan interview, as it were. And we're actually going to get right back to them because I'm interested to get their take on what we had actually done right after. So I've never snowmobiled before. Clearly, Middle Tennessee, where I grew up, my home, we don't get enough snow for the amount of snow we get is just to cause chaos in the bread and milk industry. We don't get much of that, but when we get a few inches, that people freak out. But you need more than a few inches of snow for snowmobiling. So I was super pumped about this, and as they were, but I wanted to get their impressions right afterwards and just kind of get an idea of what they thought about it. So let's get back to the Cherokee Titan here on the Nissan Nation podcast.
So what was y'all's impression of the snowmobiling?
Go ahead, Nathan. I talked last time.
I'll let you talk. I'm trying to pay attention and drive.
He's driving in the snow. Now, I thought it was pretty freaking awesome.
It was awesome. The pros were amazing.
Yeah, they were doing tricks and stuff. And then it's like, I swear it's like Nissan has on cue. Oh, insert snow now.
They also had on cue a moose.
Did you see it? Yeah, I saw that right out in front of us.
The moose was awesome.
And then I seen him kind of take off once he was like, there's people around.
She's like, I'm gone. I'm out.
I couldn't tell if it was a moose or an elk, but I saw this big...
It's a moose. Is it close enough to see? It looked like a cow.
But that, yeah, man.
That was awesome.
A few rollovers by everybody, but I think everybody, no broken bones, and we all survived that.
We did.
The guys were really nice.
They were.
They did a nice job. The skis were really fun. Once, even though I've done a ton of jet skiing, but it took a little bit to kind of get the hang of them.
Right.
But once that last mile was real fun. You could like gun it a little bit.
Going through the trees and stuff. And that's what I told one of the, one of our leaders, you know, you're doing the same thing in those trees as what you're doing on the side of those hills. It's just a mind game that you're on the side of the hill.
Oh yeah. Yeah, definitely. But, I'm curious how deep y'all think the snow was in there.
Because, waist deep.
Yeah. It had to be.
It was wasted. I tested it a time or two.
Well, I didn't want to say that. But,
I saw every side of it.
Yeah, it definitely, like, you step into it down and you could just feel the ground.
Just going.
Just going. But it's so beautiful out here.
Well, and the snow's just falling down so heavy now.
Yeah, yeah, it's just
amazing.
Big quarter size snow falling down there.
Big old wet, sloppy snow. It was a good trip, though.
What is going on, Nissan Nation? From all things Nissan here in Idaho, two parts unknown, this is your Nissan Nation podcast. And Danny, welcome to Idaho and our last night with the Titan family.
Yes. I'm getting confused because we have passed over the Idaho-Wyoming border about 100 times, and I don't even know where I am anymore. It may be the bourbon. It may be the border. I don't know what it is, but we're having a good time, that's for sure.
We definitely are having a good time, man. And this, we'll set the situation up. We're in a bar inside a house, and we got an awesome bartender.
There's a bartender.
Shout out, what is your name?
Sadie Montana.
All right. Sadie. With a name like Montana.
Listen, don't get things more confusing for me.
We're
in Idaho, but we were just in Wyoming, and now Sadie Montana is serving us some delicious, I'm drinking Colonel E.H. Taylor bourbon, which is a fantastic bourbon.
And I'm on old fashioned again tonight.
Dave's drinking like a classy old man, because that's how he rolls.
Hey, fingers up, buddy.
We got some classy drinks. I got bourbon straight up.
We do, man. So, you know, we've had three solid days of just adventure, man.
Yeah, we've been interviewing guys. We've had adventures. We've seen all kinds of, we've seen a ton of moose.
Moose, is that meese?
We've seen some mooses. We've seen some serious wildlife.
Miss Wendy Orthman, she had some encounter with a moose.
She charged a moose, or vice versa. I can't remember.
Well, do they send the receipt in for that when you charge a moose?
I think so. What else? I mean, today we went out and did a little sightseeing in the Teton. Was it Teton National Park Forest? It was national, and it was something, and it was Teton.
I seen goats and things.
It was beautiful, sunny. We saw some goats. We saw some longhorn sheep. We saw bald eagles, some bison, not buffalo, bison.
The only thing we haven't seen is Holden on this trip, you know?
Yeah, Holden, good riddance.
Holden's holding on back in the ATL.
Holden chose Disney World over this amazing trip. I think he chose poorly.
But man, we've had a blast here so far. But let's get to our first interview. We did a Titan interview today with Mr. Walter Chaney of Team Venom Racing, Danny.
Yeah, let's chat with Titan, the Titan of Titans, Walter Chaney.
Here on the Nissan Nation Podcast. So, we are going to do a Titan interview, and you guys have heard this in the past. You know that Titan interviews are strictly in Titans. So, we've got Walter back here with Team Venom Racing. And, Walter, you guys, we talked to you a few months ago. We've talked to you a little bit. But since then, you've upped the game with the Titans, man. And you went and got a... Which model did you end up getting?
So, what I decided to do was I wanted to go with the gas platform again, because their brother Alex has Black Widow, which is the diesel. So I didn't really need to go that next level and buy a diesel like him. For me, there was no reason to. So I wanted to get a new Titan, a retired Venom from truck pulling. We're just drag racing that truck right now. I wanted something I could get back into the pulling industry, and it made sense to go with the XD and go with the gas version. I mean, all my pulling classes are gas-oriented, so it was what I needed. So with that being said, I wanted something a little different. I tend to own vehicles and do things that are kind of a little neat and kind of off the wall.
Oh, I know. I've seen your live feeds, man.
You've seen it, right? Exactly. So I went with the regular cab long box, four-wheel drive, XD. There's not a lot of them on the road. They are out there, but you always see, you know, the crew cabs or a higher-end trim model. So I went with an S. So I bought, like, the cheapest base model I could find for the sole reason that the things I wanted, so people know this, the S model has air conditioning, has cruise control, has electric windows. Like, that was all I needed to survive.
Right.
And I can tell you this, I have changed a lot of things in the truck since we purchased it. We did wheels, tires, you know, put some Anthem wheels on it. We did a nice lift kit from PRG. We got some transmission mount upgrades. Hellwing stepped up. We got airbags. We got sway bars in the back going on. We're building this truck around a base model to show people that if you want a Nissan Titan and you can't afford a $55,000 version, you don't have to buy that.
Right.
You can buy a lower-end version and make it your own. And that's what I think is great about the enthusiast crowd that we have, because some people, like guys here in this truck, Tom, I want a Pro 4X. My brother did, same thing. Awesome. Go get it. It's amazing. I'm jealous, actually. But with me being more, I need to save money for upgrades.
Yeah.
I bought with the base model, and I can tell you this truck coming out of Venom, so Venom is the Gen 1 truck that I built, are probably one of the most powerful Gen 1 Titans there is, and the thing is extremely fast. Driving this bone stock XD gas, I was impressed. It takes a lot to impress me with the vehicles. I drive a lot of high-end stuff as far as power-wise. This thing was impressive. I was just the torque, the way it was towing. We have a 10,000-pound truck trailer package we tow. We towed it to Atlantic City, New Jersey for the big show down there, the JK auction show house with Smoke and Speed magazine. We towed down and back. Fuel economy was about what I expected, around 8, somewhere around near miles per gallon. But mountain passes, you know, we don't live in the flatlands.
Yeah,
well,
yeah.
What were you towing, too? I mean, you weren't towing something small.
Well, no,
we were towing 8 grand or so? Almost?
We had a 3,000-plus-pound trailer loaded with around 7,000 pounds of truck.
Yeah, exactly.
So we had 10,000 pounds
that ain't
behind
bad.
Us.
That's a big trailer.
You know, and I'll be honest, I was like, I wasn't nervous, but I'm like, I don't know how it's going to do. I don't know how it's going to do. So it impressed me.
When you and you're small, time, so you're putting a lot on the line buying that vehicle.
A lot.
Knowing that, whoa, this, you know, this might not be exactly what I needed.
Exactly. And I'll tell you what, going back to the Armadas, the Armada convinced me. I drove my nephew's Armada and said, this has the power to do what I needed to do. It's incredible. So with the right gearing and the trucks, you know, they're a little bit different setup. I put 33s on my truck, so I actually geared it up a little bit, you know, which isn't the best for towing, but it flat out impressed me. We run 70, 75 down through on the way back, no issues. Truck was great. I'm just excited to continue this build this year. And a really quick update for anybody following us. We have hooked up with Harup out of Australia, who I mentioned earlier in this podcast, and they jumped on board as a sponsor for us. So we have superchargers coming for the Gen 1 Venom and for anti-venom, which is what I call this new build. So we're going to have, as far as I know, we're going to have the first supercharged Gen 2 XD gas in the country.
Nice.
And that's our goal. And yeah. What Harup is great about is OEM fit. When you pop this hood, you're going to think it was sold by Nissan just like that.
Nice.
And that's my goal. And they're claiming good power numbers. I've seen a bunch in Australia. I've seen the numbers. They're there. They're in the 500 plus range, which is crazy. And it's extremely safe. And it's daily drivable. And that's our gig. I need to tow with this truck our other race trucks to go to these 8-10 hour away races.
Right.
We need to be reliable.
Well,
my entire career is consistency.
Right. Well, the cool thing about where you're getting that from is, you know, Australia's had the patrol in this engine for quite some time now. Yep. So they've had time to kind of get the bugs out before it gets to America, and then, you know, and then we don't want to be the guinea pigs for this. Let somebody else test it out and kind of work out the details. And I believe it's the exact same motor. So
it is. Yeah, same engine, same transmission. The tuning. I mean, the kit they sell is for the actual patrol.
Right.
So the kit they sell will go on our Armada. Direct fit. Everything's perfect. You're done. To use the kit on the trucks, we have to change up some of the piping. So we're going to get my truck to Ohio. I'm going to give a shout out to Brennan Becker out there. We're working with him through Harup to redo some plumbing for, you know, some of the stuff on it. But the kit itself is still a direct fit on the truck. So once we get those little small details figured out, which won't take long, a few days worth of work and testing, we'll have these kits available through Harup for the Titans.
Nice.
Which is super exciting to be part of that. And it's humbling for me to help create kits that are like daily drivable stuff. Not like, I'm going to buy a turbo off eBay and build this kit.
Right,
and
right.
Hopefully, well, God, I don't blow up my truck.
Well, and that, I mean, you know, we talked about it the last time you were on the show. People don't realize, like, what a small-time operation you are.
Yeah.
But you're very connected now, too. So when you have an issue, you can reach out and say, hey, guys, what, you know, like Brennan is such a great connection for the V8 Nissan community.
Yep.
You know, so I know you were able to reach out to him. Who's the people that you've been working with tuning transmissions and stuff?
So my transmission people are probably one of the heart and souls of what we do. Everything revolves around the training. And I deal with Pat Bear at a Level 10 Transmission, who's in New Jersey.
Yeah.
Pat's world renowned as far as not only his personality,
he is
just a great guy, but his talent level is through the roof. He builds transmissions for all makes and models, torque converter work, he can do it all. So when you have somebody like that, he's like the foundation of your house. You can have the nicest house in the world, but if you have no foundation, you don't have a house.
Right.
So we actually hooked up with Pat years ago and have built a relationship with him. I trust him 100%. If he tells me something, it's what I do. And every time I talk to him, he treats me like gold, like family. And that's how you have to start any kind of a build like that and what you want to try to do with that. Whatever your goal is, whether it's just you have a daily truck and you're training with it and you want it fixed. But Level 10 transmission has been it. So now with Pat on board for the building these new 7-speeds, which he's already been doing on daily driving trucks, people break their vehicles, they blow their trainings, he's already building them. We're working with him and working with UpRev to get the tuning points down for regular gas versions, regular non-boosted, all the way through to these supercharger kits. So the collaboration is what makes this happen. You know, and like you mentioned, Dave, I come from a small town of 5,000-6,000 people. I mean, we don't have money. We're just the average family doing something we love. But to be able to have connections from Nissan down through to transmission shops, but everybody is an enthusiast mm-hmm. of what we're trying to do. And they don't have to be straight up Nissan enthusiasts. They just love the fact we're promoting our brand and we're doing what we're doing. So without everybody involved, including people like you guys, you know, like Nissan Asia Podcast, they give us the exposure, they support us. If it wasn't for everybody, we would not be able to do what we do. So we're grateful to everybody else. We just put the work in, but you guys give us the opportunity to do the work.
Which I have to say is the best Nissan Nation podcast out there.
Absolutely. It's Nissan Nation podcast is real.
Right. There's no fruity cake about that. So
We're super, you know, to be able to do a Titan interview with someone like you. Like, this is rare. Like, I get to do these things, you know, with people that are close to me. So, like, having some big deals around it, like you, is awesome. So, now that you've owned the truck a little bit, I know, I'm sure you're going to wrap it like you always do. You always put these cool wraps and stuff on it. What, as somebody just kind of breaking that platform a little bit, what would be, for just a daily driver performance thing that might own the XD, what would you say to kind of look at first?
For me, if I was buying an XD gas, we'll stay with the gas platform, and if you want to do some average modifications, for me, I like wheels and tires.
Yeah, you know, you can never go wrong.
You can't go wrong. It increases, you know, enhances the look. It increases the functionality. If you go off-road, you get, you know, better tires and a factory option. I deal with Anthem Wheels. We met them in person at Carlisle Truck Nationals. The first year we entered, we won the event. Got to meet those guys. I mean, they're true blood American people with a passion to cut the middleman out so they can sell you a quality wheel at a cheaper price. So I'm going to recommend wheels and tires. If you like visually upgrades, that's what I would start with. The trucks run and drive so well in stock trim. It's amazing. The next thing, honestly, I mean, I've had the chassis torn apart. I've had the diffs out of my truck already. We've gone through a lot of things looking at everything. I love the suspension upgrades. If you want a better ride, you want a little more travel, something like that. I mean, I go with, for all my towing stuff, so say you're the average consumer, Dave, and you just want to hook up to your boat that weighs 10, 12,000 pounds, you want to tow it.
Right.
Look into a set of airbags. We definitely endorse Helwig products. Their airbags have never failed us. I have a set that's 8 years old. It's been through 8 winters up north in the salt. Zero issues.
Right.
The airbags, it's a game changer for the truck.
And they're really kind of like, nobody talks about airbags a lot, but they really are for towing. It's just a game changer, man. Most people think, oh, I got to upgrade the leaf springs or whatever. It's like, no.
You don't have to. The thing about airbags is you can run them, you know, say 5, 10 pounds, so they're really low on air. They don't recommend to run them empty. So you run them really low. You have your stock ride. It rides like a regular truck. It's not stiff. It doesn't break your back when you go over a bridge or, you know, an overpass thing. And let's say you want to go home, then throw that trailer with 4 snowmobiles on it or your camper that weighs 12,000 pounds. You can throw 50, 60 pounds in the airbags and your truck sits the same and it rides the same with that tongue weight.
Right.
So it still rides like you have a normal truck that's empty with nothing on it. It's incredible. So the airbags are huge. And I can tell you, for the first time, I really got to test out the Helwig rear sway bar. I have utilized that Venom for years, but we didn't tow a lot with that truck as far as towing trailers. So I knew it increased my traction on the track. A lot of our tracks are not flat, so we're having a little bit of a cant to them. So it really helped me pulling as far as racing. But with this truck, I can honestly tell you how it holds that truck to the road over the stock rear sway bar blew me away. And I never thought it would. I was like, ah, it's a sway bar. You're never going to know the difference.
It's a basic thing.
It is unbelievable how it planted the rear of that truck now. So if anybody's looking for basic upgrades, that is a great starting point, in my opinion. I don't really see a need to upgrade the struts or the shocks or anything crazy unless you're going to get crazy. But those things are a plus, and they're definitely affordable.
Well, you've been doing some snow racing, but you're kind of getting in, like, you're very seasonal what you do with your trucks, right?
Yeah, we're very seasonal. So all the racing, let's face it, we live in the Northeast, so racing for us is dry weather. So it's summertime racing. Dirt drags, the truck pulling, the quarter mile, eighth mile drag strip stuff. You can't really have any bad weather to do any of that. You can't have a lot of rain, you can't have any snow. So what we've done recently in the last few years is we try to expand our season. We got into ice drags. And again, this is weather permitting. You got to have good ice, safe ice. You got to have the right kind of winters. And in the last 3 years, we managed to have 2 seasons of ice drags. And we were fortunate enough to go to these drags and win our classes. So it's been great. And this Nissan platform has been just incredible for us.
Well, Walt, I appreciate you being here, man. And any other shout-outs? Because you are a man of shout-outs, buddy.
I am a man of shout-outs. So you mentioned wraps on the truck. I know wraps are an area-specific kind of upgrade. Anybody in the Northeast wants to wrap their vehicle, contact BBC Racing in Plattsburgh, New York. Bill and Kayla up there do a fantastic job. They are the small mom-and-pop business working hard 5, 6, 7 days a week. It's always at least 6. I shouldn't even say 5 for them. and they deserve the shout out because they've supported us hand over foot. They were with me when we set all these quarter mile and eighth mile, you know, records for drag racing. They were with us for the truck pulling things. So they've been there. They're not just good friends. They're just a great business to deal with.
Right. And that, you know, to kind of tie into that, that's one good thing about the Nissan community, and one sort of bad thing is, I guess, as far as the enthusiasts, there's just not a ton. I mean, you know, there's aftermarket, but, you know, there's not the variety of Jeep or Ford or somebody has.
Right.
But the people that you can find that want to do things for the vehicle really are passionate about it. They want to do it because they love the vehicle or the platform.
Exactly.
So it's nice. Like, I know PRG and all the companies that, you know, you deal with, they're like that. They're just... You know, most people think, like, you order a lift kit from, like, PRG or Nistech or whoever, that, oh, it's this big warehouse, they're just pulling something off a shelf.
It's not.
So as we wind this down, I want to say, guys, be patient with these people because, you know, they're just, you know, they're making a living like me and you. So it's not, they're not Amazons of the world.
Yeah, exactly.
So any final ones, Walt? I know you're full of them.
Yeah, I'm full of them. My God, you know. Again, going back to the only reason we can do what we do is people like UpRev, you know, the tuning aspects of these trucks. You can't really modify any performance wise without tuning. It just doesn't work. So without them, I wouldn't have a career. I would be just the average enthusiast driving an average truck, not doing anything that I want to do.
Right.
So they are my baseline as far as without them, I would be nothing. Like I mentioned with Level 10, we have so many sponsors on board. I mean, there's no way I could mention them all on a podcast. We'd be here like 15 minutes. But the people are out there, they know who they are. You know, Rouse Tire, they supply us our tread for all of our vehicles, and we win because of their tire, their choices. They work with us and help us decide what to use and what sizes. So people like that are just irreplaceable for us. You know, we got Nitrous Express, they're on board. Some of the best spray systems on the market, and I think it's the best. You know, their safe standalone system, adding your own fuel, keeps everything running the way it's supposed to be when you're spraying. I don't think there's a better system on the market, and I've looked at everything out there. That's why we run what they run. So huge shout out to Ryan out there, and you know, we got Drivetrain America. Those guys, as far as, so this is a Titan podcast. Drivetrain America, if you go to their website, they like have walkthroughs. If you want to upgrade to a true track for your differential, which, you know, some of the guys are doing now, it's becoming more popular. They have write-ups on their website for the Titan guys. So you know this, these guys own Titans. And I bet you guys didn't even know that.
Right.
So Drivetrain America, their owners own Titans. They're enthusiasts themselves. They love what we do. So a huge shout out to them for all the support. And again, like I said, I got so many supporters. I just got to thank them all. It's a general thank you guys for what you do. I hope we're doing enough to make everybody happy. We try to do as many events as possible. And I try to tag and hashtag and get everybody that little bit of a lift they deserve for entrusting in us. Because I can tell you right now, these companies, big or small, get so many sponsorship requests. I've seen them firsthand. And I know one company I talked to, we were out in SEMA this year, he receives 100 a week on average.
Yeah, and so listeners, if you, just because you have a YouTube channel doesn't mean that you're deserving of everything.
Exactly. You need to get out and earn it. One of my biggest questions, Dave, before we close, everyone always asks me, like, and there's a lot of posts, I'm sure you both, Daniel, you guys have seen these, how do I get sponsors? This is like the number one thing. Like, someday I want to lecture people and be like, if you want sponsors, there's a couple things you need to do. One, you need to work hard at what you want to do in that industry, whether it's racing a truck, an ATV, whatever it is. You need to attend events. You can't do 2-3 events a year and expect to get any kind of support that's going to sustain you. You need to get out and push. So with that being said, now you have to give it time. Don't expect huge sponsors the first or second or third or fourth year. It can happen. Some people get really lucky. But we're looking at my career this year is going on 26 years. It's taken a lot to get us here. I can show you records back in, oh my God, back in the early 90s we were setting and stuff we were winning and trophies in different industries. You just keep them. They build to your little, you know, your little note you're putting down. Yeah, I did this in the 90s, did this in the early 2000s. So when you make up your little resume, you want to send your sponsorship proposal, all that stuff matters.
Yeah, so what you're saying is 25 followers on Instagram is not going
to
cut it.
It's not going
to
cut it.
You got to put the work in on the front end to show that you're willing to do the work, that you're going to show up at things, that you're going to do that. Because
the sponsor doesn't want to sponsor you, and then all of a sudden you're like, oh, well, you know what? I'm not going to make that event. I'm not going to make this event.
Yep.
You know, I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to go out of my way to make shout-outs on podcasts or something like that, you know?
Yep. Well, yeah, most think it's free stuff, and what you get is never free.
You
work for it, and,
yes,
and for most people, they might as well buy it.
And a lot of our stuff, I mean, we have sponsors that – I have almost no sponsors that actually do actual revenue.
Right.
Like, we have very few that cut us a check or give us money. I do have a couple that have been with us for many years that do, and I'm so grateful for them. But the majority of it is a discount on product. Some free product, it's there too. We've earned that. You know, it wasn't just, oh, they gave him a free blah, blah, blah. So that's why they do it. No, we work for that. You know, we're the ones out spending $5,000, $6,000, $7,000 a year just in gas to get us the events and back.
And
not to mention lodging and entry fees.
Yeah. And sometimes you're testing products.
We do a lot of beta testing.
They say, okay, hey, we know that you're going to put this product to its very ultimate test. We want to build you a good product, but at the same time, you're like, well, it's definitely give, because you have to take something that's not proven, put it on your truck, and
yeah, it's risk reward.
It's a lot of risk.
So there's always that aspect too. But sponsorship is definitely a two-sided work together scenario.
But, and that's racing in general.
Yeah.
You're testing a product for the consumer down the road, maybe, and they want to know. And like I said, it's risk reward. So
yeah, exactly. And that's the biggest thing. And I'm going to tell people right now. This is the biggest thing that hurts our whole industry. Do not beg and plead for sponsorship. Get a sponsor, whoever they are, and then let them down.
Yes.
That is like a plague in this whole industry. I talked to so many people who are like, yeah, I gave them a free battery. Never heard from them again.
Right.
Or, yeah, they were supposed to be at SEMA. We sent them all this product. They never even showed. Don't do it. If you cannot commit, you're only hurting the industry as a whole. You're not just hurting yourself or your team. If you get that kind of sponsorship, kind of build a contract. Even if you do a legal contract. I have legal contracts with some of my sponsors. There's stuff I have to do. They have my credit card. If I don't do it, guess what? They bill me. So we have to follow through. And we always do. I've never had an issue with anybody in 26 years. But you cannot let them down. It's the wrong thing to do in general. And make sure you don't overcommit. Don't say, I can do these 10 events if you really don't know you can do those 10 events. So that's my advice for everybody. Again, we're not perfect. We still make mistakes. But we work hard every day because we want to keep growing. We want to continue in this industry. And I want to keep growing in Nissan. So we push the limits everywhere we can. But like I said, if you do anything, do it 100%. Just take that to the bank. It's never going to let you down.
Well, Walter, we appreciate you doing a Titan interview with us. And until next time, guys.
Take care, guys.
Later, guys.
There you have it. That was Walter with Team Venom Racing. And I want to say a huge shout out to Walter because he is a super class act, guys. If you have a chance, check out his Team Venom Racing page. He does it all, man. And they're currently building something called Anti-Venom, and you're going to want to follow that if you're a Titan enthusiast or if you're just an auto enthusiast. He is very fun to follow. It's not often that you get to meet some of the people you talk to in the show, and Walter's a class act, man, and I would adventure with that guy anywhere. He will talk your ear off about racing, and that's my kind of guy, man. I want to know what people makes them tick and why they want to spend lots of money to race. So now, we've got some big things going on. So, Danny, part of the excitement for this this adventure was Nissan said, hey, we're going to put you guys in some vehicles and let you drive them. And Danny's a racer. Danny, you get Danny behind anything with the throttle pedal, and he's going to test it out. But Danny, with his race program about to launch, he's in the final stages of finishing that vehicle up. He is going to need a tow vehicle. So he was super excited to get behind the wheels of basically all three Titans, the non-XD, the XD diesel, and the XD gas. He kind of had an idea of, I think, the one that he thought he would like. And I think by the end, his mind was changed. So let's get with Danny in a sort of a Titan interview, but let's get his impressions of that Titan diesel.
All right, Danny, so we just switched vehicles, man. You got to drive the diesel, which we'll do a review about in a little while, but you are now in the XD gas, man. So what's your first impression so far?
Well, you know, like I said before, the pickup on the gas motor is super, super clean and quick. And again, you know, I'm sure some aftermarket
But let's just we'll just talk about straight off the factory floor. You know what I like and dislike about some things, but straight off the factory floor, the pickup on the V8 is so much quicker and cleaner. I think a little bit more crisp, I would say.
Yeah.
Of course, you know that is a gas and diesel. It's the difference.
But you still got on the XD here. You still got great numbers, man. 390 some horse. I forget.
Oh yeah, about 400 horse. The torque is a little bit above that as well. But so, it's so comfy, man. So comfy. This is the Pro 4X version.
So it's identically
the exact same truck, different motor.
Right.
I want to say it feels a little lighter.
Really?
Maybe that's just me. I don't know. Do you guys know what the difference in weight between the diesel motor and the gas? It's got to be a few hundred pounds, right?
It's got to be. I'm thinking between 300 to 400 pounds. I don't actually know the spec on it.
Because it's an all aluminum motor versus an iron block for the, and probably iron heads for the diesel, right?
It's got that compacted magnesium block. But I think you're right though. Driving both the diesel and the gas, even in the XD models, the diesel just feels a little more industrial.
It does.
Of a feel.
Yeah.
And maybe just the extra
it could
weight.
Be in the pedal.
You
know,
pedal
it might just feel that because of the pedal. But it might. You know, it just. It could be placebo effect.
Right.
Yep. Well, I don't know if that counts here, but
it's funny.
It could be just in my head. You know?
Funny is we're. It's basically identical.
We literally.
Our buddy Scott there was like, "All right, Danny, it's gas time now," and he's like, "We're getting out of here."
Yeah, going
and
from one to the other straight off. After driving, because we drove for about 30 minutes in the one, and then, mm-hmm. you know, and you really do you get to kind of do this.
Yeah, this is
when
this
test
is
driving.
Unprecedented.
This is like the best way to really test out. You know, if you're gonna fine tooth or pick apart the differences between the trucks.
So Nissan, you're doing a great job on selling Danny on the Titan.
Yes, this is the way to sell me a Titan. I'll tell you that much. I'm really leaning towards this one, and I'm there's all kinds of different things. Different strokes for different folks.
Granted, it's just motor difference. But so now you've drove the gas V8 here in the heavy duty frame, and now you've drove the normal non XD. So can you tell a difference?
I don't really tell a difference between the non XD and the XD. To tell you the truth, maybe I don't know. I'd have to go straight into the non XD.
Yeah.
Again,
I bet we can make that happen.
Yeah, which may be possible. Maybe I'll drive one on the way home. But yeah, it's I don't know. This is where I'm feeling at home. I'm feeling the gas, and you know, my mind may change, but I'm feeling the gas or XD.
Well, I think for the normal person who may just tow once in a while, you know, maybe a couple times a year their boat or wherever they're going, I think the gas makes more sense because the diesel, depending on what part of the country you're in, is more expensive. There's a lot more maintenance to it. It's a more expensive maintenance to it, where the gas engine is, you know, oil change, filters, you know. It's pretty simple, but yet you still have a lot of capacity to tow in this thing.
Yeah, I think it's just so much more convenient, in my opinion, for me in the day-to-day. And you know what? I was leaning more towards the diesel. And I mean, you said it a million times. You love your gas, and you kind of love how you your truck. And you were saying, don't bother with the diesel. You're not that deep into the towing world to get the diesel. I'm definitely leaning towards the gas. It's just this gas motor is like impressive.
Smooth. It's
dude.
Smooth.
It's
man.
So smooth. The transmission, it doesn't seem, you know, it's a seven speed transmission. I haven't noticed, and we're going through mountain roads right now.
Yeah.
I haven't noticed any gear hunting. I haven't noticed any, like, the gear changes are crazy smooth. It's probably partly because there's so many gears. They're really close together. You're not feeling a big change in RPMs. You're not feeling a big change in power levels. It's just very smooth top to bottom in what you're getting in the transmission. And
Daniel,
I think that...
you should mention, you're driving through the Rocky Mountains.
Oh.
Yes.
Rocky Mountains.
At altitude.
At altitude. That's true. This is... And, yeah, I mean, it's really impressive. It's been a real joy to drive, to tell you the truth. I could road trip this across the country after.
Could you see this being a family vehicle then?
Yeah, all day, dude.
And you, I mean, you have three kids, so I think each, you know, there's
so much space in the back that it wouldn't even be a big deal.
Right. There's two larger gentlemen, not by larger by waist wise.
No, they are
by,
just massive dudes.
Yeah, by feet wise, and everybody's comfortable, man. Luckily, I'm the shortest guy here, so I can shove my seat up if need be. But
yeah.
But we really hadn't had to do that.
Yeah, space in here is great. The center console, I love the center console. It's got really good usability. And the other guys don't agree with me, but I have a problem with the wiper stock, something about it. Maybe I'm just so unused to the difference between other truck and this.
It does take a
little
bit.
Maybe it takes a while to get used to. I don't know, though. I've driven these trucks for 3-4 days now, and I'm still frustrated with it. Maybe I'm an idiot. Maybe it's just me.
Yeah, but
the wiper stock isn't as...
But I think some of these things are, once you own a vehicle like this and you're daily in it all the time,
sure,
and you get out of your head a little bit.
I won't think about it, but
right.
The last couple days, every time I wanted to use the wipers, it's not as user-friendly as I think it should be for just getting in a vehicle and pressing the things.
Just pressing buttons. I need to press buttons. But like you said, the overall layout, these have heated seats, it's leather seats, the dash and everything, all the stitching, man, it's very,
It's got cooling seats too, right?
Yes.
Hot
or cold.
It's got what I like to call the Hummer seats.
The Katy Perry model.
Yeah.
As we've
been told here. Little blowies on the
But the stitching in the dash of these vehicles is, 10, 15 years ago, this would have been a Lamborghini doing this stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Honestly, Ferrari or somebody with this leather-stitched dash, and now Nissan has it in their trucks. The radio system in these things, like we were saying, the fender system now is great. We're in an older one now that has the other radio system, which is the Rockford Fosgate, which is still a very, very nice system. The trim, I will say on these trucks, the one thing that bothers me is the chrome trim around the air vents. And why that does is the sun, every once in a while,
just hit
that,
yeah,
and
it'll
be right in your eyes.
I can understand that.
And that's every manufacturer does that.
I will say if they just did the gray and then the vents, it would take away some of that, like, really nice look. I mean, it looks really good. Like, normally I don't really like a chrome on much of anything in the car, but, like, this, like, light chrome accent around the start-stop button and around some of the stuff, it classes it up big time. Mm-hmm. And maybe they could have gone with something a little bit different as a contrast,
right.
You know? I think maybe, even a gloss black would have been a cool contrast.
Are you with the start button? This
I love
is new
start
to you,
button.
Right?
I love it. I love it. Well, I mean, it's on my Armada.
Okay.
But this is. I like to. I love the fact that there's no key. It's obviously the way of the future, but it's so much nicer to not have to yank your keys in and out of your pocket.
Or just nothing banging you in the knee as you're driving.
Oh yeah, yeah. I'm surprised it took that long.
Right.
for people to start putting them in.
Well, it is a bummer when you go from this to a Frontier.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh, a key, what is that about, man?
I hate having my key for my Frontier.
Right.
But, I carry it on a carabiner on my belt because I hate digging into my pocket to get a key out and having a key in your pocket and having to pull it in and out or whatever.
Right,
so,
and once again, 10, 15 years ago, that was something on only high-end sports cars and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean, no, is this a Diablo or some Lamborghini, something like that? No. But it's funny how those features start trickling down into the the everyday drivable cars.
Yeah.
We are at a cowboy bar, and giddy up, man. We are looking at, instead of bar stools, they have saddles that you sit on.
Nissan was nice enough to bring us here for a nice refreshing drink. As you can tell, the atmosphere is loud, and it's very country here.
Yeah, this is the cowboy bar. It's the million-dollar bar. The bar tops have inlaid coins into them that are apparently worth $1 million all put together. I think there's some gold coins, and so there's some super old silver dollars and whatnot. So
I tried to pry them out, but I couldn't get any out.
Yeah, I used my teeth, but that still didn't work.
They're in there. Well, Danny, we've been on an adventure today, man, seeing animals and all kinds of wild things.
Yeah, and they're scooping ice behind us.
Right, and tonight, man, we got the final night and a big dinner. What Corey is cooking us some kind of barbecue.
Yeah, it sounds like ribs, beef ribs tonight from Corey. I'm sure he's got a bunch of other things up his sleeve, and I think everybody's going to go hard tonight with the drinks. You know,
right,
last
right.
night finish it out strong.
Yeah, it's after this trip. How do you survive paying for your own drinks again? You know.
Yeah, for sure. But it's been good. I've had a good time, man.
Had a very good time. Let's go have some more fun.
When you were, you know, you're attending an event like this, you and everything's been five stars. How do you not have five star food? And we were treated to that. We were given Mr. Corey Barr. If you go over to his Instagram and check out everything he does, it's CoryBahr. And Corey is a brand ambassador for Nissan, and he runs his Titan everywhere. Whether he's down in Louisiana, he's down at the coast. I'm sure he's gathering all kinds of fresh foods and everything to prepare for his restaurant. But we had him in Idaho this week, and God, was it amazing! I'm kind of a picky eater at times. Those that know, I'm kind of a you know, steak and potato kind of guy, even though I sadly don't get those potatoes really anymore. But I thought I'm going all out, man. Whatever they put in front of me, I'm going to try. You know, when better can you get, you know, probably $100 meals each time for free, basically, on this trip? And why not try it? Whether you like it or not, you know, we're going to give it a go. And there was nothing, I mean, nothing that wasn't put in front of me that I didn't love, man. From the lobster tails to the what was it, elk, to venison. And it was all just, oh my God. If I could be next to Corey and when he's cooking all the time, I would greatly be probably 1,000 pounds, because it's all delicious. So guys, go check out Corey's page and, you know, just show some love that way. That's these guys. They really like it when, you know, just give him a follow on the Instagrams, and I'm sure you can find him on the web. But as Corey would say, he finds the best damn ingredients he can, and then he just gets out of the way. So I love that philosophy, and my hat's off to you, buddy. Thank you for feeding us. And speaking of feeding things, you know, somebody had to put this event on and organize it. And Nissan, when they need something for their social medias or some advertising, they look to Fluid Peak and Mr. David Page. And I want to say a big, big thank you to David. He, I don't know how the guy slept the whole week. He was just on everything. I mean, I don't think there was anything the guy didn't handle, whether it be, you know, just basic questions or how he kept us on track, kept everything organized. And, he really, I mean, the guy is epic. Go check out David. He's, in Fluid Peak. If you see anything from Fluid Peak, it's, all due to that man and his staff. And speaking of his staff, I want to say thank you once again. You guys work so hard to keep everybody happy. Even when they really didn't know they were, you know, they needed anything, you guys were on top of it, taking care of us. So I want to say thank you to his staff, because they all worked their asses off. And I mean it. They we partied into the night on this final night, and they took well good care of us, and I'm just blown away. I'm blown away by, I do events, and nothing to this scale, and I don't think I could ever, like, there's been benchmarks in my life for things I do, and there's a new benchmark, man, because these guys from just handling social media for Nissan trucks, they build everything, like base camp, snow patrol, surf camp, or whatever they called that one. That's all because of them. Nissan gives them an idea of what they want it to, you know, kind of the theme they want to go with. And this guy, he builds it. And in some cases, he's given weeks to do it. So, the guy is just, he's just an epic, epic guy. He's an adventurer, I think, like me and Danny, except he's to the extreme. We think we're extreme, and he ups it about 100 times. So let's get to the interview with Mr. David Page of Fluid Peak, and let's pick his brain here on the Nissan Nation podcast. What's up, boys? All right, guys, so we have a big, big deal in the house here. We have... I've got to build it up. We've got Mr. David Page with Fluid Peak, and David, first off, we want to say thank you. I know this is a split thing between you and Nissan. Like, you organize it, and Nissan takes all the credit for it. We understand that, but like we've seen the hard work that you guys have put into this. Like the organization, the weather causes chaos and everything. So first off, we definitely want to say thank you for having us out. It's a big deal for our little audience, and they really feel connected through, like, we've tried to do a lot of live stuff. They really feel connected through what we do. But we want the history of how did you get connected with Nissan?
the abridged version.
Yes.
I'm sure it's a long story, but...
Yeah, the Nissan for Dummies version. Oh, how do we get here?
Fit into the puzzle.
First of all, this is Nissan's event. They pay the bills. I facilitate for them.
Right.
Let's see. How did I get affiliated with Nissan? Well, my first recollection of a truck in my life was 1980 with the very first Datsun King Cab long bed in my hometown of Idaho Falls.
Right.
Which facilitated camping and fishing and hunting and everything with my dad and my grandfather. Always had a passion for Nissans. I prefer Datsun. I don't know why they call themselves Nissan. It's Datsun in my world, but whatever. I was in a duck blind with a few people from Nissan, and they were talking about lifestyle.
Because right, you do guide work too, right?
I used to. I've had a production company for about 10 years.
Okay.
And I used to guide full-time.
Right.
Fly fishing, big game hunting, whatever it took. Spent a lot of time in Africa. And really what we do is lifestyle work.
Right.
And they were talking about how they needed to associate Nissan with brands and how to become a lifestyle brand. And I said, well, part of that is you know, your visuals, your content. It can't just be, you know, the Titan sitting on a loading dock in a pretty perfect situation, because us as enthusiasts, you know, that doesn't always sell it for
right,
them.
Right, you got to play to their imagination, not what they do every day.
Yeah, exactly. Right. You know, so let's pretend we're all sitting in a cubicle right now, and when you've got your device, whatever it is, your desktop, your phone, your tablet, whatever, you're aspiring to be the guy you're looking at on the internet.
Right.
So I told those guys that, you know, they need that. And one of the gentlemen gave me an opportunity. I'm very gracious to him, Thiago Castro.
Right.
He gave me the opportunity to prove that what I was talking about, and he facilitated a truck so that we could shoot photography.
Which I heard you got a pre-production truck. You just did a few things with it to show him, here's what I can do for you. It's kind of what I've heard.
Well, we started out with photography on an event.
Right.
We did a duck hunt in Texas, and we created images for them. And,
right.
And the images were crucial for a few things that they were trying to do. And we had a meeting, and one thing led to another, and we built Base Camp, Project Base Camp for Overland Expo a couple of years ago.
Right.
And Base Camp was, I don't want to say it's iconic with the brand, but...
No, but it was an instant hit.
It was a hit. Yeah.
Because we're very connected to the Overland community, and
right.
They're like, all because nobody was playing to the full-size Overland truck.
And I think a lot of people wanted to see. They, you know, you see the truck and you say, I know that truck would look awesome with XYZ if somebody took it and really did a nice build on it. And so all of a sudden that popped out and we said, yes, someone finally did an Overland version of the Titan. So that was really exciting for us. I know that when it first came out.
And that's kind of what really started it all. Project Base Camp was the start of Fluid Peak with Nissan.
And of course, you guys have moved on to a lot of builds now.
We've done between 5 and 7, I can't remember now.
And I know by the time this airs, you'll have a new one release, and which will be kind of exciting.
We've got a couple coming up, and one pretty shortly here.
Nice.
And we're pretty excited about it. And, you know, really what we're trying to do is help establish Nissan as Titan as a lifestyle brand.
Right, because
it's an outdoor truck.
Right, and there's a lot of people that don't know that Nissan even builds a full-size truck, so
exactly.
They need a lot of help. Like,
exactly.
They need some marketing of like, hey, we built a truck, let's do it.
Yeah. Exactly.
So through that, obviously it's grown for you in Fluid Peak, and you've come to down to events like this where you're kind of, this is a pilot event, you're trying to show Nissan basically, hey, we can bring all these communities together, whether it be a dealer, Nissan itself, or the enthusiast, which really no manufacturer does. A lot of times they bring in a rider who thinks they're an enthusiast to the brand, but they really don't care about the brand, or they're not the guy that's going to own the car for 10 years. So this way, you guys have brought in somebody that's going to own the car for 5 to 10 years, whatever.
Right.
They're going to modify it, maybe not. But you're showing, you're taking and putting Nissan corporate directly with consumers, which really doesn't happen.
It's never happened.
Right.
This is the first event of this kind, and, you know, it was a gamble, and it, it was their idea, and they asked me to help facilitate it. And I've tried to we run the social media page
right.
for Nissan Trucks on Instagram and Nissan Trucks on Facebook, and we really try and connect with our consumer, the end user, and that's you guys. You know, yes, there's a lot of other people that you have to cater to and take care of to help market the truck.
Sure.
But at the end result is you guys are the buyers. So if you get it and they get it and we bridge the gap, we win the battle.
Right. And of course, you know, Nissan, they don't have a budget of a GM or somebody, so advertising is crucial when they can do it. But social media is like where the internet kind of took the phone book and got away with the phone book. Social media is doing that now with advertising.
Yeah, completely.
Like you don't need to go spend $1 million on or whatever a Super Bowl ad costs anymore, because you can do grassroots efforts like this and get the same maybe feedback that. And then you have actual realistic feedback of what you see in real time, where it's a TV advertising, you're guessing basically at what it's reaching.
Exactly. Our goal for the entire event was to give you guys a platform to talk to Nissan directly, but also to give Nissan the chance to show the end user that, hey, we are listening,
right.
And we love you guys.
Right.
This is a celebration for you guys. We're saying thanks.
Right.
I think that was one of my biggest takeaways from this, was seeing that Nissan really cared about the end user, and they really wanted to make sure that they were building a truck for the end user, and that the entire company was focused on bringing forth, you know, a product that and connecting with people that use these trucks and do fun things with them, and showing the world that they're not just some kind of giant corporation that made a truck. They're a corporation that cares and that makes a really cool truck, and they want it to be used in cool manner. You know,
exactly.
They want it
exactly.
to be utilized, and they want to see how they can better the world with it, basically.
Exactly.
Well, and to be honest, you know, Nissan, the first generation Titan is an uphill battle. You're never going to compete with Ford or Dodge. You're 50 years from ever going to get those sales numbers if you keep at it. But they also, before you guys come in, they have this XD, which is a weird mid, who knows what it is, platform. But you're showing people by taking consumers out like this weekend where maybe they're just a non-XD V8 owner, and you're showing, here's what this truck is, the next step up is really capable.
Yeah.
You know, and so with them wanting to release a new Frontier coming up, you know, the Frontier is an entry level to this, get them into the Titan, and then go XD, and then they're in the ultimate vehicle.
Well, you know, I'm very passionate about the XD myself,
right.
Okay? A half-ton truck doesn't always facilitate what I need. But I don't need a $90,000 three-quarter ton truck. So I'm very passionate about the XD. And for anybody that thinks that it's too much truck or not enough truck, I empower you to get in the truck and drive the truck.
Right.
Because when you drive it, you understand and you get it.
And whether it be the V8 or the Cummins diesel.
Either or.
Because,
either or.
Because honestly, I think, in my opinion, most people, the V8 would be more than they need anyways.
Quite honestly, and I've had several now. My favorite truck that I've kitted out, I had a Nissan, I guess it was an 18 King Cab. It was one of the first King Cabs that had a V8 in it. I mean, I love the way it sounded, I love the way it fit, and I love the way it looked.
Right. Right, and of course, you know, with Nissan, they need the Cummins diesel just because they need the brand to
brand recognition.
Yes, and even though the 5 liter is a small diesel, it's still a great motor.
It's a sleeper.
Yes,
the 5 liter diesel, everybody goes, oh, it's not an inline six, so it can't be any good. That's wrong.
Yes.
No, it's not a burn the tires off, roll coal truck.
Right.
It's not supposed to be.
And if a small diesel's so wrong, why is Ford putting a 3 liter in their next truck?
Why did Chevy bring out the Colorado with the Duramax in it?
But then you got to go, why did Chevy bring out a 4-cylinder in a full-size truck? So that's a whole other
thing. Yeah, I think my big takeaway, too, is in the XD model, and this is my first immersion into the Titan. I've,
I've been around them and stuff like that. But my biggest takeaway was the actual front to back full design, the brakes, the chassis. Whether it's a diesel or a gas, the takeaway is this is a truck built front to rear like that. It's not just about the motor. It's the it's the full package of what it can do in its size. You know, it's a smaller truck compared to some of the others.
It has the capacity to do the same amount of work.
And it's also a bargain in the market, man.
Yeah.
I mean, if you go to compare basically the same luxury package as you can get in a Titan, you're almost $15,000 cheaper.
At least. Yeah. I've said it time and time again. Nissan Titan, or Nissan Titan XD specifically, is the best valued truck, period.
Right.
Absolutely. It has the best warranty and it's the best valued truck out there.
So as we kind of wind this down, With Fluid Peak, I mean, do you obviously you have a partnership with Nissan,
yeah.
So you want to continue to do these things, but do you see, is there something else out there that, and I'm not trying to pry into the future too much, but is there, they have Frontier coming up, like you guys seem to be like big with trucks. I think did y'all do the 370 track car and all that?
Fluid Peak facilitated the media excursion for the first run, and we created all the assets.
Right.
We didn't build the car, no.
Okay. But I've seen it being towed behind
base camp
and the Armada
and Snow Patrol.
Right.
Yep.
Which, guys, I'm super happy. Like, for some reason, that Armada speaks to me.
Yeah,
like,
we both got a chance to get in the Snow Patrol, and that thing is so plush.
Like, I had
it's so nice. Car. It's a nice truck to drive.
Fluid Peak built Project Mountain Patrol.
Yeah.
And I wish we had a chance to show you guys that vehicle, because it's just every bit as plush and a little more user, for the off-road guy. But the Snow Patrol is, there's something about that blue.
Yeah.
That blue is just beautiful.
And dear Nissan, find some new colors like these blues. Like they pop so well.
I hope we have the chance to, nothing's ever for sure. Every day's a new day. But I hope we continue to facilitate great content and do great things for Nissan on the trucks platform.
Right, and to our listeners, just because the podcast was here, don't think that the next go-around is not just an ordinary listener or consumer of the product.
Yeah, well, just on that, let's celebrate the other people that are here. I was happy that you guys could be here. But we had the regular everyday Joe guys.
Yes, yes.
We had a couple of guys that seriously were like, I don't know why I'm here.
Right.
Yeah, they had, a couple hundred followers on Instagram. The guy said, I just got this truck like a couple months ago. I don't even know why they invited me, which I think was amazing, because it's just they want to get the end user, whether they're an Instagram star or whether they're just enjoying their truck.
There's also a person here that doesn't even own an XD. He has a Frontier.
Yeah, that's awesome, which is awesome, which you probably...
I was going to say, I bet they own an XD or something.
That's me.
We hope so.
That's actually me. I only own the Frontier.
Let's have a conversion rate.
I can guarantee you I'll have an XD after this. But yeah, it's very cool.
Which we were super excited about, because you'd never had any time.
I got to drive all of them, so it was perfect for me.
Which, for a test drive, if you're a listener and Nissan invites you to this, you're getting to test drive everything. It's like
perfect conditions too.
And the dealer's not going to go, here, let's just open up our fleet of vehicles to you. So it's definitely been exciting to kind of get to experience everything that Nissan has to offer with it.
It's been a great event, and we're really happy with the way it turned out and how happy you guys are about being here.
Yes, we were super excited. And David, I want to say thank you from all the listeners. We've tried to do a lot of live content. We wanted our listeners to feel like they were a part of this.
Yeah.
Whether it be one view or 1,000 views, I don't care. I just wanted, we always say that this show is not us, it's our listeners. And we really want to convey that. And I think you guys proved this weekend that this wasn't Fluid Peak. This was the enthusiasts, this was the journalists, and this was Nissan, everybody coming together.
This was Nissan.
Just coming together and enjoying it. So we really appreciate it, and thank you for inviting us.
Oh, thank you guys. Appreciate you being there.
There you have it, guys. That was the Titan Adventure. I want to say a big thank you to Miss Wendy Orthman over at Nissan Corporate. I want to say a big thank you to Corey Barr, the chef. I want to say a big thank you to Fluid Peak, and especially to David Page, who you just heard in the interview. David worked his ass off. There was nothing we didn't need, nothing that his staff didn't do, and his staff just, they took care of everybody. So I don't know how you guys did it. I do events, and there's a new benchmark. I can tell you that for sure, man, because these guys, they are just on top of it. If there was something that just couldn't go because of the weather, they had 14 other plans to make sure that we never had downtime. And my hat's off to you. I know it's a big deal. And guys, there's going to be more of these. I know, talking with Nissan Corporate, they were excited. You couldn't have got a better balance of people to show up. And there's no way they could have known that. I mean, the planning of this was just fantastic. There was people that I knew there. There was new people that I didn't have a clue about, that maybe you were a listener to the show. I want to say a big shout out to my buddy Chuck there from Florida. There was brand ambassadors. There was a lady that was a fisherman, a fly fisherman. That was just one of the most epic people I've ever met. Just a great personality. There was rock climbers. It was whatever you do with this vehicle, however you use the vehicle, there was somebody there representing your community. So they did an awesome job. I'm blown away. We're going to have some stuff on YouTube about it. We're actually producing a little short on it. You're going to hear Danny in the next episode. I'm sure we're going to review this a little bit better. Guys, I'm just blown away. I can't say thank you enough to everybody that put this on. And you know, if you ever get the call to adventure, and you see a Nissan trucks in your DMs, you better answer it, guys. I can't say that enough. And don't pester these people, because they're not going to come to you. They want people that unknowing is how they want to do this. I guess my dog Brooks there needs to shake around. Welcome now, Brooks. Welcome to the Nissan Nation podcast. But they really, guys, don't show, the way they're going to find you is you just showing love to the brand, whether it be you on Instagram posting up just cool shots of your Nissan trucks in particular in this case. And just they're watching, guys. They really are. So if you tag Nissan in something, be ready to adventure, man, because you never know. One of their trips was to Morocco. And could you imagine me and Danny in Morocco? We probably wouldn't have came back. Somebody would have killed us or something, because we're too crazy. Anyways, that was the show. I hope you love it. Once again, if you will go to our YouTube page and just show us some love there. Hit that subscribe button. Hit the bell if you really love us. It means a lot. Once again, we're really pushing for YouTube this year. We want to build that channel up. As of right now, it's in its infancy. So please help support the show by doing that. You can also help support the show by going to our website. And we have a little Amazon banner on there. If you click the website, you'll find it. If you're doing any shopping, please just do it through that. If you're going to do shopping on Amazon, click our link. That's all I ask. And the show gets a small kickback, and it does help feed the monster that is the Nissan Nation podcast. And as I've always said, this is not the Dave, Danny, and Holden show. This is your show. I hope that through this podcast that you feel like we represented you guys well. And you know, I hope you enjoyed. Not everybody could be on the show or on the Titan Adventure, but I hope you felt a part of it, whether it be on our Instagram page, our Facebook, or our YouTube. So from everybody here at the Nissan Nation podcast, to my awesome wife Kelly, who helps produce this show, to my buddy JR, who done some of the music, to my brother from another mother over there on the West Coast, Danny, and to our buddy Holden, who didn't get to adventure with us this time. Guys, it's been 4 great years, and I cannot see stopping this show. And so from everybody here at the Nissan Nation podcast, my name is David Boyd, and we are out. Peace, everybody. Love y'all.